Welcome to the teaching ministry of The Anchor, Calvary Chapel, San Pedro. We invite you to join us as we journey through God's Word together, learning how to be anchored in Jesus and reflecting His grace. Here is Pastor Jerry Cesario with today's message.
Father, open your word to us tonight as we look at more of wisdom that your word has for us. We're going to hear the word wisdom 1,000 times tonight, Lord. Don't let it pass us by. As your word says in the beginning of Proverbs, wisdom calls out from the streets. It's in the busy marketplace. It's wisdom of your Bible is there for all of us. If we would but hear and obey and just and receive your words of wisdom. And let us do that this evening as we look at your word. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, as we continue, blessings. Bless you. As we continue in the book of Proverbs, one theme that will be ever present, again, is the plea for all that read this book to get wisdom at all costs. In a crooked world, a world that seeks after anything and everything that is opposed to God, opposed to His Word, we need wisdom. It's essential for us. Solomon has been really still opening the door for why we need wisdom. We'll see that transition tonight when the Proverbs themselves begin. The little short liners or the short few sentences, we'll see how that starts to come at us. But he's still in a process of showing us how to get wisdom. Go get wisdom. Why we need wisdom. And it's so important for us in this day and age. Now, how else are we going to navigate this world? How else are we going to navigate November 5th, for crying out loud? We need God's wisdom as God's people to be able to deal with the issues of this world, to deal with the issues that we are facing, to deal with the issues that are in our own families and our homes, our jobs. And, you know, we need godly wisdom to be able to do that. Again, don't forget, we're getting through the book of Proverbs, godly wisdom. You know, apart from the instructions that God himself has given us throughout the scriptures, but especially here through Solomon, whom God declared was the wisest man that ever lived. Don't forget that. When we read these, I'm still blown away by that as I really begin to think about that. It's not just pithy sayings. In the introduction to this, we saw how Solomon, you know, God appeared to him and said, ask of me anything, and I'll give it to you. And Solomon said, you know what? I'm a child. How do I lead this people? My dad was a good king. I'm brand new at this. I want wisdom to lead your people. And God said, oh, you have asked for the right thing and gave him wisdom. And the scriptures tell us that, and Jesus even affirmed that. Until Jesus came as the full embodiment of the Word of God and the wisdom of God, before Jesus, the wisest man who ever lived on this planet was King Solomon, according to the gifting that God gave him. So the things that we're reading in the Proverbs, we need to remember that. We are getting wisdom from a man whom God poured out the gift of wisdom into. How else would we expect to live without this wisdom? And this is where Solomon begins now, with the instructions for his children to learn to get wisdom at an early age. Verse 1, chapter 4. Hear, my children, the instruction of a father, and give attention to no understanding. For I give you good doctrine. Do not forsake my law. When I was my father's son, tender and the only one in the sight of my mother, he also taught me and said to me, let your heart retain my words, keep my commands, and live. As Solomon imparts wisdom to his own children now, he reminds them that he was once taught by his father, King David. He was taught many of the concepts that he is teaching us now. David was a man of many passions. We know that. But he was also a man who sought hard after God and wanted to please God with his life and his decisions. So David asked for God's wisdom too. And David received God's wisdom. Solomon got a double portion of that. In fact, that was one of the prophecies that Nathan gave David and Bathsheba, that God was going to pour out his spirit upon Solomon. And that's what Solomon kind of hints at that. When I was my father's son, tender and the only one in the sight of my mother. Remember, David and Bathsheba had sinned. The whole issue had, you know, he tried to cover it up by, you know, lying and then deceiving and then murder. And then, you know, he lost his firstborn son. The result of the sin between him and Bathsheba, but God came and restored not only David's life, but we don't read it as much, but we know by implication, his mother, Bathsheba, was also restored. She became a good queen mother. She had wisdom in the days when it came for David to turn his throne over to his son, and he had to do it early because of, you know, some, you know, nice intrigue going on in the castle, and Bathsheba was the one who went to Nathan and said, look, you know, God promised that Solomon was the one that was going to reign. But now David's other son, I can't remember the name right now, is vying for this attention. This is after Absalom and all that. And Nathan inquired of the Lord and said, you know what? You're right. God said he's not going back on that. Tell David to turn the throne over now, early. To Solomon, make it sure, because God has put his hand upon that. And Solomon, you know, he recognizes that the wisdom he was taught by his father and the wisdom that he's obtained in life, he's now imparting to his own children. And he tells them, look, I'm giving you good wisdom. I'm giving you good teaching. Don't forsake what I'm telling you. Let your heart retain my words and keep my commands. And notice that, and live. This is wisdom for life. And we're going to see that really heavy tonight. Wisdom for life. Living as God's people. Again, David had been forgiven of major sin. Solomon was the visible result of God's redemption. So it makes sense that David would then pour wisdom into his precious son. And what a great example that is for us. Pour into our children all that God has done for us. Ultimately, what this opening does is says a lot about preserving wisdom and preserving godly traditions from generation to generation. You guys, that's why we need to pray so hard for this Friday night and for upcoming outreaches to the youth. There's a whole generation of teenagers, young adults out there that were not given godly wisdom. They haven't been raised in church. They don't know a lot about God and about Jesus, other than, you know, they hear his name probably spoken a lot on campus in a negative way. And they need to be shown. They need to be given the wisdom that you and I have been given. We have been called to pour into that next generation, especially as parents. Through the help and guidance of the Lord and through the passed down wisdom and experiences of those who have gone before us, we can receive great instruction. That's what Solomon's opening the door here for. But there's an exhortation here for us. We must be willing to listen to the wisdom of the previous generation. You know, that's what we do. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, Calvary Chapel pastors, right? My own pastor, you know, handing over their pulpits right now. Jack Abelin, Morningstar Chapel, has retired and he's handing over his pulpit. He has poured every ounce into the guy that's taking over. In fact, in a couple of weeks when I go to my monthly meeting, that the pastor that Jack Abelin has now turned his pulpit over to is going to be sharing with us men at our monthly prayer gathering as Calvary Chapel pastors of the LA region. There's a lot of guys right now that are doing that. There's a lot of guys that have done that in years past. There's a lot of commentators. I read commentators. In fact, I always use the phrase the old dead guys. You know, and it's funny, my one commentator, you know, that I'm reading, it's Ray Ortland Jr., and he mentions the same phrase. Maybe that's why I heard it. I don't know. You know, just, you know, these old dead guys have a lot of wisdom to impart to us. They've walked the path before us. God has given them great wisdom. We need to listen to them. We need to be, in turn, pour into the generation coming up behind us. Well, it's good, but we need to listen first and hear and learn. Proverbs 4 basically is alerting us to the value of past voices and the benefits to be seen if we do. But then the plea for the listener and reader goes out very strong now. Look at verses 5 through 7. Get wisdom. Get understanding. Do not forget nor turn away from the words of my mouth. Do not forsake her. She will preserve, and she will preserve you. Love her, and she will keep you. Wisdom is the principal thing. I love verse 7. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. And in all your getting, get understanding. I love this. Get wisdom. Get understanding. In all your getting, get understanding. What does that mean? Well, Solomon says here, in all our getting, because honestly, we have no problem seeking after our desires, our dreams, everything for ourselves. So whatever else we do, we should never forget this. In all of our getting, make sure that we get wisdom, godly wisdom. It is the principal thing. It's the only thing. Once we have wisdom, godly wisdom, then we will truly have everything we really need. Because only a life that's lived for God is really what counts. The main thrust of all the wisdom in this book will help us. That's what it's there for. Wisdom will guard and guide all of our choices. Wisdom will decide what friends we make and who we avoid. Wisdom will determine our business, our financial choices. Wisdom will decide who we marry and how we raise our children. Ultimately, wisdom will decide what we believe and how we will live out what we believe. Listen, there are only two kinds of wisdom. The world might want you to think that there's many. There's only two. The wisdom of the word and the wisdom of the world. 1 Corinthians 3, verses 18 through 20, the Apostle Paul is very clear about this. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you seems to be wise in this age, let him become a fool that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, he catches the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile. Those are from the Proverbs, by the way. Notice the powerful promises that Solomon reveals here about getting godly wisdom. God's wisdom will make you alive, verse 4. God's wisdom will keep you. It'll guard you. Verse 6 tells us that. God's wisdom will bring promotion and honor to you that others will see and learn from your example. Wisdom's great. We need it. That's why Solomon continues, exalt her, and she will promote you. She will bring you honor when you embrace her. Remember that illustration that Solomon has begun with, wisdom as a woman. It's just a very illustrative and poetic way of putting wisdom out as something we really want. She will place on your head an ornament of grace, a crown of glory she will deliver to you. I love that. Solomon is saying that this is how life is supposed to be for those who trust God and seek wisdom on all things. Wisdom will crown you with glory. You will be one that people look to. Don't you want to be someone that people look to? You know, I think we mentioned that before, you know, the E.F. Hutton. We should all be an E.F. Hutton for Christ. When we speak, people should listen and want to listen to what we have to say. That is, if we're giving godly wisdom. You can read books about worldly wisdom. You know, don't put your money under your mattress unless the economy is about to fail miserably, but then you got to be careful who you're listening to. You know, godly wisdom is what we want to give to people. And if we pursue wisdom in that way, she will honor us. She'll lift us up. People will come to us for advice. I love when people ask for advice. I equally love it when I have to say, you know what, that's a really good question. Let me get back to you on that because I have to go search it out myself. because that's what wisdom is all about. Don't pop off, give somebody bad advice. Wisdom also brings long life. Look at verse 10. Hear, my son, and receive my sayings, and the years of your life will be many. Now, it's a general rule that a life free of addiction to vices, you know, any vices, including drugs, alcohol, sexual sins, gambling, whatever, I mean, just a life given over to this world will result in short lifespan in many cases. Diseases and death and just the destruction of the body. But here, godly wisdom doesn't just say, don't do it, don't touch it, don't. Godly wisdom says don't, and then gives you everything you need to know on how to avoid the pain, how to avoid the sorrow, why God wants you to have life and freedom from the consequences of sinful living. That's the good thing about wisdom. And Solomon distinctly puts that down to get wisdom and you'll have a long life. You'll have a life free from anxieties that many people have because you've chosen to look to God when situations arise in your life. So remember that. You know, you should be sleeping well at night when you seek God and he gives you wisdom and you make a decision based on your prayer and reading of the scriptures. You know, Christian, rest. Let God work it out. See what the next day brings. Verse 11. I have taught you in the way of wisdom. I have led you in the right paths. When you walk, your steps will not be hindered. And when you run, you will not stumble. Take firm hold of instruction. Do not let it go. Keep her, for she is your life. Notice how many times already we've been told that wisdom is life for us. Don't forget that. Solomon had taught his children wisdom. He had led them by example. I don't know what happened with Rehoboam. After Solomon passed, Rehoboam threw all the wisdom of his father out the window, and that started a long, nasty road of division in the nation of Israel. I guess he should have read, you know, chapter 6, the six things that the Lord hates. And the final abomination that the Lord hates is disunity and discord among his people. We won't get to that this week. That's next week. Solomon reiterates now that your path with the Lord will be guarded and guided well, should you heed the advice and pursue godly wisdom. In fact, the idea of taking the right path will be a common, persistent theme in the book of Proverbs. Verse 12 is more impactful in the Syriac version of the Bible as it's rendered this way. As thou goest step by step, I will open up the way before thee. I like that. The idea being that the Lord, through his wisdom, will guide us step by step through life. And we can rest in faith that he will not send us on the wrong path. Don't you love that? If you seek God, if you pray, ask him for wisdom, remember what James said, right? Anyone is lacking wisdom. If anyone asks of God for wisdom, he will give it, and he will give it liberally. He's the giver of good gifts, and wisdom is one of the things that God will give you. And here Solomon reminds us, if you go after godly wisdom, if you put God first in all of your decisions and read his word and get wisdom from him through the Holy, we have the advantage of the Holy Spirit today to bring guidance to us in a way that even the ancients never had. And if we do that, God will light the way before us. He will guide us. He will direct us. Well, having said all this to get us to pursue wisdom, get wisdom, now a series of Proverbs really start to begin. These are the little two-sentence blurbs or several sentences. The instructions for wise living begin in earnest now. So verse 14, we're going to read through verse 17 and cover these verses here. But this is our first kind of proverb itself here. Now, remember, we've just been told that wisdom will keep us on the right path, right? Well, look what happens when you don't get wisdom. Do not enter the path of the wicked. Do not walk in the way of evil. Avoid it, do not travel on it, turn away from it, and pass on. For they do not sleep unless they have done evil, and their sleep is taken away unless they make someone fall. For they eat the bread of wickedness and drink the wine of violence. You know, in contrast to the path of the wise, Solomon now gives us the illustration of the path of the wicked or the unwise. Verse 16 itself is a stark reminder of the insidious nature of sin. Once you are in deep, sin consumes you. And once sin has started to consume you, you will eat, breathe, and sleep sinfulness. Notice that. Or in this case, don't sleep because you're always consumed with the next thing to do, the next sin to commit, the next person to draw into your web of deception. I mean, it just goes downhill from there. This advice that Solomon gives us is sound and profound. Do not enter into the path of the wicked. Do not walk in the way of sinners. Do everything you can to avoid their ways. Do you see that? Don't investigate it. Don't pass by. Don't get close to it. Like, well, what's this all about? Is this really a... Stay far from it. Don't get into it. Turn the other way. Pass on by. Note the urgent warning here in these commands. Avoid a life of sin. It may seem interesting, intriguing, even thrilling, but it eventually will destroy you. And we know that. The devil is the great master of putting the bait out there. Hiding, you know, we'll read in a moment how the path of the righteous is bright and gets brighter every day, but the path of the wicked gets darker every day. The devil is good at hiding the hook. The bait looks good. He's deceiving. He doesn't tell you how dark it's going to be once you take that hook. In other words, there is forgiveness for our sins. Let's be clear on that. Many of us have strayed, and God has restored us. But if we just determine once and for all that we will not enter down those paths, we do far better. It is all too true that once we enter the path and travel far down it, sin becomes more and more evil and more natural and accepted. I mean, nationally, internationally, that's where we are as a world today. Jesus spoke of how bad things would get. Isaiah, the prophet, was told by the God himself, the day will come when they call evil good and good evil. This world thinks that we are evil. I don't even know. We did a Facebook boost on our youth night thing. I was hesitant, and I told Aaron, I go, yeah, did a boost once, just got a lot of bots and, you know, fake accounts and stuff. It's just Facebook trying to pad your page with likes so that people go, ooh, this page is really popular. But things have changed in that. But we did this post. I did it yesterday afternoon and immediately started getting likes from bots. They're called bots if you're in that thing. That's just a bot. It's not even a real account. I'm like, oh, gosh, you know. And then all of a sudden I started noticing a bunch of crying faces and mad faces. I'm like, okay, why, you know. And then between yesterday afternoon and early this morning, we got 10 or more people with the nastiest comments, these like, you know, Christianity is the opiate, you know, religion is the opiate of the masses, and pictures of people, you know, oh, now we're preying on teenagers, you know, and it P-R-E-Y-I-N-G, and then somebody posted a picture of the, you know, Catholic priests beheading all the Incas, and just like all this nasty vitriolic. And I'm just like, what? So I had to get it. First thing I did this morning, I couldn't do it on my phone. I had to wait till I got to the office to just cancel that whole ad campaign. It's like, I don't know if it's, what's Facebook doing? Put our post for a youth night out, and I've got to delete like all these posts, like 10, 15 posts I have to delete off of our thing because it's just like, what did their algorithm say? Hey, here's a church. Just go ahead and attack them, you know? So my point is, the world hates us, or AI does. My wife is like, it might be AI doing that. I'm like, that's even worse if AI is generating, you know, vitriolic posts against a church event. This world's in trouble. Verse 17 even conveys an even more tragic image. Bread and wine were the staples of life in Bible times. They were things that were necessary for life. So what Solomon's saying, what God is saying to us, is that the farther down the path of evil one goes, the more they find that lifestyle of sin and wickedness becomes as natural and even as necessary as food and drink. That's why we are to avoid sin. Avoid the path of the wicked. Don't stop. Don't just pass on by. Just avoid it. Christian, Jesus came to die for our sins. And when he came to die for our sins, that meant he came to set us on the path of righteousness. And then he gave us his word of wisdom to stay on that path. And that's why you and I, I've never reiterated enough, you and I have a unique advantage this side of the cross. We have the Holy Spirit to help us and guide us in a way that they didn't have back then. They did. The Holy Spirit moved upon them, and through the prophets and the kings and the priests, they did receive that. That's the way God, that's the way his economy worked then. But you and I have something special, something way different. And we need to take full advantage of that. The Holy Spirit can give us wisdom in an instant, in our own prayer life, in our own devotional life, in our own jumping in the car and on the way to the grocery store or to the bank, and we need to pray, Lord, how much money do I need to get out? You know, I'm looking at the checkbook. The Holy Spirit can give us wisdom and guidance right then, right there. You don't have to swing by the church and talk to the priest or the pastor. Holy Spirit can speak to you in your walk with him. That's what he did. That's why he gave us the wisdom and put us on that path. This is exactly what Solomon wisely says next, as he takes us back to the path that we're supposed to be on. And if we are, what life really looks like. Verse 18. But the path of the just is like the shining sun that shines even brighter unto the perfect day. The way of the wicked is like darkness. They do not know what makes them stumble. Wisdom shines like the sun to illuminate the path of the righteous. But the wicked stumble in darkness of their own sinful night. Two things really stand out here, and I like this. The path of righteousness becomes better all the time. Just like the sun rises, and you know in the morning, and it starts to rise, especially here, we get these beautiful sunrises out over the east, you know, which comes over the port for us. And, you know it's sunlight, you know, if you're one who has to set your alarm, you hate that when you toss and turn a little and you realize it's starting to get light outside. But you know what? The sun starts and it starts to bring light, but by noonday it's blazing and everything's lit up. But that's Solomon's point. The sun becomes better all the time. The brightness by the end of the day, it's there for us. Well, spiritually speaking, as wisdom is obtained and choices to follow the Lord become more natural, the path becomes brighter and clearer. And he says, unto the perfect day. That means the more you seek God for wisdom, the brighter your life is going to be in God. And one day it's going to be perfect because you're going to hear that trumpet and you're out of here and you're on into heaven for all of eternity. The contrast to that, as wisdom is shunned and sinful choices become more natural, the path becomes darker. To the point where sinners don't even know that their own sins are simply finding them out and that their lives are just a mess. Just darker and darker. until eventually there's just no way out of the darkness. And sadly, for us, the perfect day is coming when we are with our Lord and Savior for all of eternity in the brightness of the sun, S-O-N, for all of eternity. In fact, in heaven, the Revelation tells us there will be no more sun, moon, or stars in the new heaven and new earth, because we'll have the brightness of the sun and God's brightness lighting us up for all of eternity. Which, taking the analogy here, the contrast to that, if you're not in the presence of God and in his light, that's what Jesus described as outer darkness. It'll be dark for eternity, because the people that go deeper and deeper and stumble down into their choices of darkness, eventually there will be no light left for them on into eternity. That's a sad place. That's why we need to share the gospel and tell people, come to wisdom. Come to Christ. Solomon continues, my son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Note that. Listen to the word. Heed what it says. Do not let them depart from your eyes. Read the word. Read the Proverbs often. Remember, there's 31 Proverbs. There's one for every day of the month. And if you're really savvy, when you hit, you know, March or when you hit February, you just read the other three, read four in one day, get more wisdom. Keep them in the midst of your heart. Well, that's something that David taught his son, right? Your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against thee, O God. Hide the word in your heart. Hide the Proverbs in your heart. You know, it's kind of an interesting thing because I've never taught the book of Proverbs. But I've read it all my Christian life. And, you know, I don't know, I've probably read it 100 times or more. And it's funny, as I'm reading these things, there's sometimes when I'm teaching a book where I'm kind of like struggling, like Hebrews, and I'm struggling a little bit here and there, like, how do you teach this? And what does this actually mean? And stuff like that. But when I'm reading the Proverbs, there's this thing going on in me where I'm like, yeah, 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 yeah. You know, because I realize exactly that. Been reading it all my life. And yeah, I still need to rightly divide it. I still need to, and there are certain verses that are coming out where like, oh yeah, you know, I really want to dig into that a little bit deeper and teach it a little bit deeper, you know, and stuff like that. But I realized, you know, today as I was typing and as I've been reading for the last couple of days in my study process, I'm like, you know what? Solomon's dead on. You put these things in you, and you invest the time in putting these in you over the years, it does come out. And I'm thinking, wow, it probably has come out many times, just in life and decisions all the way around. So praise God for Solomon's obedience and for God's wisdom. So here, I'm imparting that to you. Verse 22. So we incline our ear, we listen, we make sure we're reading and using our eyeballs that God gave us, and then keeping our heart filled with God's word, for they are what? Life to those who find them, and health to all their flesh. Now, then it gets really serious here, and this is probably a verse that you've read and or heard before. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. Joanna walked into my office to ask me a question the other day, and I had just finished, you know, reading the thing about this, and you walked out of my office, you had asked me something, and I said, Joe, she's like, what? And I go, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. And she goes, what? And I'm like, just playing with it. Since wisdom from God is necessary as air, water, and food, it needs to be kept safe in our hearts. The heart, scripturally speaking, is the seat of our emotional being, who we are. We're to get God's word into our hearts, right? We're not supposed to, like, go to a surgeon and open up and have it stuffed in our, you know, ventricles. It's who we are. It's the emotional seat of who we are. Life does not flow from the outside in. For the world, it does. For many people, they just garbage in, garbage out. They take in whatever the world wants to give them. That's their form of wisdom. For you and I, God's word is to be in our heart. And then it flows from the inside out. It's expressed in our actions, the way we walk, the way we talk, the way we act as Christians. In other words, when we live for the Lord and live wisely from his word, it will flow naturally from us. So we must have our hearts continually filled with the things of God, so that from us springs the rivers of living waters that Jesus promised in John 7. If we don't keep our hearts with diligence, and that word literally in the Hebrew means vigilance, so it means to guard our hearts, to guard the wisdom that God is giving us and putting into our hearts. If we don't keep our hearts with diligence or vigilance, and we allow all the muddy ponds and puddles of this world to fill us instead, then we will not have wisdom to even flow out the way God intends. Nothing worse than a stagnant pool. You know, you ever had a koi pond that you let go, or, you know, or try to get one? I tried to do that once. My late wife and I thought it would be cool, and we had this backyard. There was a couple railroad ties already there, and we thought, well, if you put some plastic down, and that didn't work. Gross. That's not what we want. We want fresh living water. And that's what Jesus promised us, that he would pour into us, and it would pour out of us. And then Solomon says the same here. But how do we keep our hearts with diligence? That's the question. Well, good old King Solomon is going to tell us exactly that. Put away from you a deceitful mouth. So watch your mouth. And put perverse lips far from you. Watch what you say. Let your eyes look straight ahead. And I would say, keep your eyes on God. For us, keep your eyes on Christ. And your eyelids look right before you. So just keep your eyes on Jesus. Ponder the path of your feet and let all your ways be established. Think about your choices. Think about what paths you're going to take when things arise. So if you're watching your mouth, not getting involved in gossip and, you know, or grumbling or complaining or, you know, or whatever, and life is not good for you, you know, that's sin, because God has given you life and breath and everything you need. You're not lacking anything, especially as a child of God. Yeah, you know, your pantry may be a little empty. Come to the church, raid our shelves. You know, God has everything you need. Don't grumble and complain. Don't covet for what others have. That's a sin. Because what you're saying to God is, you haven't given me enough. I don't trust you. I don't think you care for me. And that's not true. So watch what you say. Keep your eyes focused on the Lord in prayer. And then ponder the path. Think about, okay, how are we going to do this? What are we going to do? How am I going to take steps for the Lord? And that's in everything. That's in our families, our lives, our jobs, our walk with him, our choices for sin and not to. Everything comes down to that. Do not turn to the right or to the left. Remove your foot from evil. When we carefully ponder where we are headed, it helps us to establish our wise direction and helps us not to turn to the right or to the left. Jesus reminds us too in the Gospels, walking with him is a narrow path. Well, not to turn to the left or to the right. It's one way. We go one way. So evangelistically speaking, that's absolutely true. There's only one way. But in our own lives, I think it was Isaiah, I can't remember the reference right now. I still have it on my phone. I could look it up, but that'll take time. Because somebody told me that when I came to San Pedro. A wise woman from my church sent me a text, and she quoted the verse in Isaiah where it said, you know, the Lord will be behind you and in front of you. Do not turn to the right or left. Listen to him and follow him. And that's what I've done for 10 years. And I still have that word on my phone. The choice to not turn left or right only comes when we keep our feet on the right path to begin with. That's what Solomon's been bringing us to here. Now chapter 5. My son, pay attention to my wisdom. Lend your ear to my understanding. See the urgency yet again. I'm about to impart something else to you. Now listen, that you may preserve discretion and your lips may keep knowledge. For the lips of an immoral woman drip honey, and her mouth is smoother than oil. But in the end, she is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps lay hold of hell. Lest you ponder her path of life, her ways are unstable. You do not know them. Solomon begins now, and he'll return to this several times in the Proverbs. And if you've read the Proverbs, you've seen these passages. He begins with the perils of adultery and sexual immorality. In this chapter, the Lord gives us the wonderful gift of wisdom in the area of sexual pleasure that he designed in the bond of marriage. However, in verses 1 through 6, the blunt warning of going against his wisdom and design is now given to us. And as you will see, it is a two-part message. Keep your hands off every other woman and keep your hands on your wife. Now, I want to preface this. I'm glad there's no children in here. So, we have some married couples in here. We have some single people as well. We have various ages of people in this room. So, this is all God's wisdom. So, this is going to speak to all of us. Even if you're, you know, going to be married soon, or you want a wife, or if you are just someone giving counsel to young men and young women in their lives. This is wisdom for all of us. So, as Roy Ortland said, the Bible is very blunt about these things. It doesn't sensationalize them, but it doesn't mute them either. So we're going to enter into some territory. We've got a few minutes. And I will be, you know, open, PG-13. So in the first section, it refers to not following or being led down a path by an immoral woman. The immoral woman spoken of here, the word that's used, is a prostitute. And more specifically, one who hires herself out for religious ritual prostitution. And this was seen in the ancient days. Women would do that. Even married women would leave their husbands and go into a life of ritual prostitution. And many Hebrew women did that too. In fact, that's what Hosea's wife Gomer did. She may be thought of here as a symbol of sin or of evil of the world or false religion, as some try to say, or of idolatry, and all those things can apply. But any other, seductive temptations of what men deal with can also be looked at here. And Solomon says, beware. Beware. We've already been told not to follow the path of the wicked, and now young men, because he's speaking to his sons, but even to us today, men need to be aware of the dangers of a woman who has adultery on her mind. If you're married or she's married, you know, I kind of broached the subject last time, but now it gets pretty serious and very illustrative. He says her lips drip like honey. That means sweet and smooth. She's a flatterer. She's slick, a clever talker. The enticing offers that she gives for moments of pleasure, though, will surely end in bitterness, wormwood. It's a bitter root known well in the ancient world. If that root of bitterness, wormwood, grew too close to a spring, you couldn't drink the water anymore. It was bitter. What we're told here is to really ponder her life. If she's leading foolish men to hell, and she has already made her bed there. And look what he continues to say. Therefore, hear me now, my children, and do not depart from the words of my mouth. Remove your way far from her. Do not go near the door of her house, lest you give your honor to others and your years to the cruel one. So there's a warning of the shameful stigma that will follow for years to come. And adultery does have a stigma. Now, our culture, our society is trying to make light of it, but it does have a stigma that lasts forever. And if you grew up in a divorced family because of that, you know exactly that. It is horrible. Adultery is a horrible thing. It says, lest aliens be filled with your wealth and your labors go to the house of a foreigner. In other words, you're going to lose your livelihood. You'll lose everything. Someone else will take over your family, your own wife, your own situation because you forfeited it. And then it says in verse 11, and you mourn at last when your flesh and your body are consumed. That's the devastating physical consequences of sexual immorality and destroyed lives and, you know, the diseases and communicated diseases and things that come with it in addition to all the emotional distress and destruction of a life and a marriage. And say, how I have hated instruction and my heart despised correction. I have not obeyed the voice of my teachers nor inclined my ear to those who instructed me. I was on the verge of total ruin in the midst of the assembly and the congregation. Notice he's speaking to God's people. Those who fail in this area that belong to the congregation, that belong to, in our case, the church. You know, something seldom thought about before we enter into deep sexual sin, and especially adultery, is the hardness of heart and bitterness towards God and refusal to come back to Him later in humble repentance. That's what Solomon's saying. This is the worst kind of misery at all. To finally have to admit that we could have avoided an ocean of pain, but that one was too stubborn to heed the advice and not go down that path. Now, again, from a New Testament perspective, Jesus came to free us from sin and the burden of sin. And even if this has been a choice in the past, He wants to make sure you're cleansed and on that right path now. And I hope that if there is anybody in here that has dealt with that, maybe never really brought it to Christ, deal with it. And you know, and even if you have and you've repented and God is good, you're living in a new situation now, and Paul deals with that in 1 Corinthians 7, doesn't he? Where you are now, you live now, you move and you work from that point now. But don't let the enemy then try to put guilt and shame on you either. The stigma is gone in Christ Jesus. But be careful. You have to make probably harder choices now to, or more clear choices to avoid anything that would cause that again. Now listen, having been very clear, Solomon gives some very sound wisdom for his son and all men everywhere and in every age to find their sexual satisfaction in their own wife. Again, I'm going to be quite frank here, PG-13. The reason why we have so much problems and dysfunction in the church in this area is that churches do not address it biblically. And we teach the whole counsel of God. Solomon says, drink water from your own cistern and running water from your own well. Should your fountains be dispersed abroad, streams of water in the streets? The metaphor here is water. Water is refreshing. The metaphor shows us how God views the wonderful sexual union between a husband and a wife that He designed. Men and women have a thirst for sexual satisfaction. Let's be open and honest about that. It's the way we were created. Some men have a raging thirst. Some have been blessed with celibacy. Very few, but some have. But for the other 99% of the population, there's a thirst for sexual satisfaction. And what God is saying here through our brother Solomon, who was the wisest man who ever lived, men, satisfy your thirst through lovemaking with your wife. I gave her to you and you to her so that all your needs will be fulfilled in that area. And with my highest blessings upon it, by the way, drink from your own cistern and running water from your own well. It's a beautiful, poetic illustration of that, but it's got a deep truth. While the Bible warns about sexual sin and immorality to be avoided until one is married, and you know, you got to practice some discipline if you're not married, to the married, he says this: the remedy for your thirst for sex is sex. overflowing sexual joy with your wife. That's what it means by your own cistern and running water from your own well. I like that. I caught something after I had done all this. Running water implies consistency. Doesn't Paul say that? Don't deprive one another except for prayer and fasting. So wives, you know, or husbands, I guess. If you say like, oh no, I'm praying and fasting. You better be praying and fasting if your spouse comes to you and it's like, hey. I love that. Running water, consistency. It's to be a normal part of marriage. You're not to drink from anywhere else but your own home. Men, I read this week and I just, men, your own wife is your personal, private, and divinely given and approved wellspring of endless sexual satisfaction. God gave her to you. Women, you are the only woman on the entire planet with the morally legitimate calling to bless your husband and fulfill all of his sexual desires that the enemy hammers him every day. You realize that you have been called and chosen by God to take care of your husband. And you're the only one that God has given to him to do that. What the Bible is saying is that what God has put together and blessed is perfectly fulfilled in the marriage bed, and he honors every man and woman who get this and, well, get into it. Again, running water, consistency. I'll probably come back to some of this when we get to Hebrews chapter 13. The wisdom being imparted here is for men to not seek, any satisfaction outside the marriage, because it will only end in heartbreak for you and everyone else involved. And sadly, this is a problem, as recent estimates have shown that, I read this, about 85% of men have premarital sex. And then after marriage, about 25% of men and 15% of women commit adultery. The numbers for both men and women who view pornography are also astounding. About half of men and a third of women view pornography, married men and women. You know, I'm grateful for such a strong emphasis that the Bible gives us for sexual health and marital bliss. Again, if you're married, take this in. Have a talk with your spouse about these things. If you're not married, you know, take them as wisdom to give to someone one day. Or take them as wisdom for yourself if you want to be married and you're moving in that direction. The language that Solomon gives us here in the next few verses is actually quite erotic in a good, healthy, biblical way. I hope I'm handling this okay. Let them be only your own, speaking of the wife, and not for strangers with you. Let your fountain be blessed. He already gave us what the fountain is. That's our sexual relationship. Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice with the wife of your youth. As a loving deer and graceful doe, let her breast satisfy you at all times and always be enraptured with her love. For why should you, my son, be enraptured by an immoral woman and be embraced in the arms of a seductress? The imagery here is beautiful. Rejoice with the wife of your youth. And I read this, you know, I'm thinking, well, I'm getting kind of old here, you know. And I think it was John Phillips that said, doesn't matter who your wife is or how old you are, she's always the wife of your youth because she makes you feel young again. I like that. I don't think I need to say anything more necessarily on that. You guys get it. Men, go back and read it. Tease your wife on the way home with the words of that. For the ways of man are Solomon now reminds us that God is always watching. For the ways of man are before the eyes of the Lord, and he ponders all his paths. His own iniquities entrap the wicked man, and he is caught in the cords of his sin. He shall die for lack of instruction, and the greatness of his folly, he shall go astray. Listen, wisdom is available for all who want it, for those who want to come to God on his terms, and those who reject it do so to their own shame and folly. And now some new wisdom is imparted. Didn't realize that was going to take the whole hour. We're going to have to just come back next time. In the next chapter, God will speak wisdom into three areas of our lives. How we handle money, how we discipline ourselves, like live a life of discipline, and how we build community. So we'll pick up chapter 6 next week. Hopefully we've learned some wisdom tonight. Father, thank you for this word. We look forward to coming back together next week and continuing on and learning more.